Welcome to our special update on managing investment risks in the coronavirus. My name is Natalie Comino. I'm a portfolio specialist at MLC Asset Management, and I'm joined by Al Clark, our head of investments. Welcome, Al.
Thanks, Nat.
Concern about the coronavirus is sweeping the globe. What's the latest?
So when you think about what's going on in China, it's probably starting to stabilise at the margin, but the issue that everyone's confronting right now is that it's spreading globally. So we're seeing it spread to 65 countries, I think, at the last count, with around about 3,000, unfortunately, about 3,000 deaths. So in an environment like this, I think people try and find historical precedents to lean on to help them understand what's going on. So people tended to straight away go to SARS as a useful precedent. That turned out probably not to be a great precedent. SARS was quite contained. The disease itself didn't spread quite easily. People have looked at the swine flu from 2009. I've even seen people go back and look at the Spanish flu of sort of 1918, which again, very different disease. I think the reality is it's quite hard to know exactly how this will play out. What we do know at this point in time is that it's a highly transmittable, highly communicable disease with a fairly low mortality rate.
And what are the issues as you see them?
The key issue at the moment is how countries are going to react as it comes into their shores or sort of as it crosses their borders. China was quite militaristic in the way they treated it. And that was seen, I think at the time it was seen as quite extreme. So in hindsight, that probably seems like the right way to approach something you don't understand. Mm. The problem with that type of response is its impact on growth. And we're seeing that now. So in the weekend, the February manufacturing PMI, so the sort of the index to show how manufacturing is going in China, was really low. It came out at something like 35.7, which was even lower than November 2008. So it's the worst, it's the slowest that reading has been out of China since the crisis, or actually I think in recorded history. So the impact on growth from being so militaristic and shutting things down was quite profound. So what happens now is other countries step back and think, right, well, what do we do? Do we follow that type of route or do we have our own way of assessing it?
Does it affect how we invest?
So fortunately it doesn't for us. So the MLC manage, we manage the diversified portfolios using the investment futures framework, and that naturally lends itself to accommodating new risks. So we tend to think about all the possible range of outcomes and then think about, okay, well, what's that distribution of outcomes? How does that impact our portfolios? So something like a pandemic, we actually had a pandemic scenario. So we then look at that and think, okay, we've got the right sort of parameters around that as this evolves, and then understand how it's then impacting the overall holdings in our portfolios.
So what does it mean for our portfolios then?
We came into this year, or this quarter, we came in fairly defensively positioned anyway. I think we were concerned about the valuations across a range of asset classes. And so we're quite defensively positioned. In the Inflation Plus series, we've got an overweight to gold as a real rate hedge. We've got an overweight to foreign currencies, particularly US dollar and the yen. They do well when growth does badly usually. And we've got a large overweight to volatility through a sort of tail risk hedge. So all those parts, the defensive parts of the portfolio have been doing really well in the last few weeks or the last month. And so now it's a matter of when do we start to change that. We've already changed the gold position, I'll be honest. So we took profit in that gold position last week, but maintained upside exposure through calls. And we're looking at the other positions just to make sure that they're, as the market gives us the opportunities to adjust those, then we'll make the sort of decisions as those events transpire. That's in the Inflation Plus. In Horizon, Horizon was already underweight slightly in Australian equities. Horizon's overweight foreign currency exposure. And then the Horizon and the Index Plus series, through their investments in Inflation Plus, inherit all those defensive characteristics. So overall, the portfolios were quite well positioned. Well, not well, it's always hard in an environment like this to feel like you're well positioned, but they were defensively positioned, and we've been making changes at the margin as the opportunity presents.
Yep, so taking some profits where they were available. So what happens next?
As I sort of said, there's a broad range of potential outcomes from this, depending on how countries react. The good thing is in our process, we don't need to be epidemiologists or specialists in viruses, etc. We just need to think about that potential range of outcomes and then lay that over our distribution of returns and say, okay, is this risk-reward trade-off sensible? So for us, what happens next is not necessarily the important thing. For us, it's the fact that we've already been able to embed in our process, in our investment process, this type of risk. And then we sort of, by that, we tend to make the future a little bit irrelevant.
Some of our investors are concerned at this time. You've been investing in the markets for many, well, probably decades now, Al. What would you say to them?
So if they've been invested for a long time, then they've been through the benefits of the last, 10 years really. So they've participated in a significant rally in markets. So this type of correction is not really outside the realms of possibility at all, is it? So I would suggest probably just to be patient. And fortunately, that tends to be the way most people treat their investments. We were defensively positioned particularly because things looked expensive. As they become cheaper, that's actually a good thing. So we'll look for opportunities to improve the overall risk return profile of the funds, take those opportunities as they present themselves, and hopefully be able to give investors a nice way of navigating through these types of events.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Al. Thank you for your time and your insights.
Thanks,
and thank you for joining us.